Es un día. ¿Me están viendo? Sí. Bueno, estamos todos muy contentos y ansiosos para escuchar al doctor Fischer en este día festivo para algunos de nosotros. Así que agradezco a todos los que están presentes. Vamos a tener el gran honor de escuchar una vez más al profesor Fischer. Sobre la descripción general de la inmunología de COVID, incluidas las situaciones de las inmunodeficiencias primarias. La realidad que le tenemos que decir muchísimas gracias por estar acá, agradecer también el patrocinio de SSL Behring, que nos ha permitido realizar este webinar, y también contar que durante todo este año, como ustedes me han escuchado, la CID estuvo presente en un año tan terrible como la pandemia, que nos permitió, por un lado, reinventarnos y poder comunicarnos. Y la verdad que resultó, porque en estos 8 meses pudimos realizar encuentros donde Latinoamérica, la región, estuvo presente, donde diferentes referentes de la región pudieron dar actualizaciones sobre la situación de COVID en los diferentes aspectos. Hicimos 8 webinars. Hicimos también 3 webinars de casos clínicos sobre los pacientes de la región con COVID, y esto va a llevar en mano de la doctora Gisela Seminario, Sara Espinosa y Alejandra King, una presentación para poder publicar lo que pasó en la región. Hemos hecho 2 webinars sobre angioedema hereditario, llevados por la doctora Annette Grumman, el doctor Eli Mansour y la doctora Natalia Fili. Por supuesto, los 2 eventos tan importantes para la comunidad LACID, como la conferencia del doctor Casanova en agosto y hoy el doctor Fischer. La verdad que estamos muy contentos, también muy entusiasmados, porque tenemos unas nuevas comisiones dentro de la CID que están sumamente activas con nuevos proyectos. Creo que un poco los he cansado, pero ellos me siguen y estamos pensando tener un 2021 con muchas actividades. Una de ellas, que va a ser un gran desafío para nosotros y para nuestros jóvenes, sí, vamos a hacer nuestro Summer School en forma virtual, el 18 al 20 de marzo. Estamos esperando que todos el 15 de diciembre eleven sus propuestas de trabajos y currículum, donde vamos a tener actividades con conferencias, actividades de presentación de casos, de desafíos, también lúdicas, y vamos a tener esta vuelta, vamos a premiar el esfuerzo que van a hacer nuestros jóvenes. De los 5 trabajos mejores, van a presentar el año que viene un webinar especial de esos trabajos frente a toda la comunidad LACID, y además van a haber 2 premios sorpresa para los mejores trabajos. Así que LACID activa. También, dentro de esta actividad, para poder seguir conectándonos, para pensar que el COVID no solamente no vino para quedarse, porque creo que todos estamos esperando las vacunas, vamos mientras tanto a saber esta nueva modalidad que nos va a brindar diferentes aspectos sobre las inmunodeficiencias primarias para su diagnóstico, un curso de citometría de flujo que lo va a dictar la doctora María Isabel Galiar, el diagnóstico genético sobre errores innatos de la inmunidad a cargo de Cecilia Poli, clasificación de errores innatos de la inmunidad, la doctora Ekaterin Gudoris y Alejandra Kim, y un simposio de ADA 2 llevado por el doctor Ignacio Urarte, 30 de abril, y muchos trabajos más y muchos encuentros donde esperamos que activamente la CID diga a su comunidad: estamos presentes. Como siempre, por favor, registren. Demostrar que estamos, demostrar que en la región hay pacientes, es muy bueno, no solamente para la sociedad, sino para nuestros pacientes, que requieren visibilidad. Ya hemos visto en diferentes encuentros la necesidad que tiene la región de tratamientos que aún hacen falta en muchos países y creo que con el registro podemos ayudar a que esos países puedan tener representatividad y puedan llegar a sus gobiernos para que los pacientes no queden sin tratamientos que son tan necesarios y que hoy nos cuesta mucho pensar que esto no es así. Por supuesto, repito, que dentro del registro de la SID tenemos un registro especial para pacientes COVID, por lo cual los seguimos invitando. Ya ven que importante es ser miembro de nuestra comunidad. Nosotros estamos muy orgullosos de ser latinoamericanos, debemos defender nuestra región y debemos demostrar que podemos y podemos trabajar en conjunto con todos los continentes y saber que nuestros pacientes se merecen los mismos diagnósticos y los mismos tratamientos. Por eso es importante estar todos presentes en nuestra comunidad. Y ahora sí, yo sé que no me quieren escuchar a mí, sino al doctor Fischer. Bueno, lo digo en castellano porque me están traduciendo. El doctor, ya saben que ha tenido el foco en los errores innatos de la inmunidad y sobre todo el camino de la cura a través de la terapia génica. Es miembro de las academias de Estados Unidos y francesa de las ciencias. Es miembro también de la Academia de Medicina de Estados Unidos y Francia. Y por supuesto, es un honor saber que es profesor del colegio, de la escuela, es decir, experimental de Francia, de la medicina experimental. Es realmente un gran honor contar con usted. Muchísimas gracias, doctor Fischer.
Thank you very much, and this is a pleasure to be with you. And I say hello, good afternoon for me, good morning for most of you, I guess. So I will share my screen to show you the slides of my talk. I hope you can see them. Is it okay in terms of, can you see the slides? Yeah, okay. So I'm going to discuss what we know and what my view, my overview, my personal overview of immunology of the disease COVID-19. Let's start by a brief summary about the virus itself. As you know, this is a coronavirus with a single strand RNA that is inside the virus here, which is quite a big virus with 109 nanometers of diameter. Within coronaviruses, there are several families, two big ones, the alpha and the beta coronaviruses. And among them, there are seven viruses known to infect human beings, four from the alpha family. These are leading to benign upper respiratory tract infections. We mind that, but because this has a little bit of importance in terms of protective immunity to SARS-CoV-2. Then there is the beta coronavirus family, and here are the problems, because the three viruses we know, they are all bad viruses causing very severe pneumonia. The MERS-CoV that emerged in the Middle East, the SARS-CoV or SARS-CoV-1 in Eastern Asia, and now the SARS-CoV-2. As you know, these are zoonoses, that is that the virus emerged from animals and went to humans. It's thought that for the SARS-CoV-2, the ancestor came from the bat, but there has been probably an intermediate passenger, but it has not been identified yet. So you see the structure of the virus at the outer membrane. There is the so-called spike protein, which is very important because this is through this protein that the virus binds to cell receptor at the surface of cells and can infect cells. You will see in a second which cells can be infected. So on the right figure, you can see the SARS-CoV-2, which comes here with the gray and purple image, binding to its receptor in green here, the main receptor, which is ACE2, angiotensin-converting enzyme 2. And this is through the yellow part here, the so-called receptor binding domain of the virus. In addition of ACE2, there are other proteins that are involved in the binding and the endocytosis of the virus, such as TMPR, SS2, which also plays an important role. But I will not go into the details here. So what are the targets? And there are many targets. Unlike many respiratory viruses, SARS-CoV-2 is able to infect many cells in the body because many cells of our body express this ACE2 receptor. But the most important target is the oropharynx, where our epithelial cells express at a very high level this ACE2 molecule. So it is known that it's here in the oropharynx that most of the virus replication occurs. And this is why we can infect or transmit the virus through particles. But in, of course, then the viruses can migrate into the lungs, and the lung cells, epithelial cells, again, express to some extent the receptor. But in, on top of that, there are the epithelial cells in the gut that also express the receptor. And it is known that some of the patients with COVID-19, they have gastrointestinal symptoms. And this is explained by this. But this is not the end. Vessels, so endothelial cells in the vasculature can be infected, and we will see later that this is important in the severity of the disease. And then the heart also, and so on. So not all of the cells of the body, but many cells, starting with epithelial cells, are the targets for the virus and can be infected. So a few words about the disease. As you know, in many individuals, the disease is asymptomatic with no or very few symptoms. But at the other extreme of the spectrum, there is the possibility, the risk of acute respiratory distress syndrome. And these are those patients who may die from the disease. And this is related to infiltrates in the lungs of extending importance. You can see here on these CT scan images. But the frequency, fortunately, of severe cases is low. Is only a few percent. And the death rate, as you may know, of the disease overall is actually today around between 0.5 to 0.7% of infected people. So few people die, but still the disease is very contagious, so that at the end of the day, the absolute count numbers are pretty high, as you know. And if we look a bit in the details of what's going on in the lungs, there are several kinds of lesions related to the immune response I'm going to discuss in a minute, at the level of alveola with edema and water entering into the alveola, of course, which is not a good idea in terms of getting oxygen from the respiratory tract. There are microthrombi, as shown here, so because of there is a disease of the endothelial cells themselves. And there is a vast infiltration by mononuclear as well as polynuclear cells related to inflammation. And this is associated with cell proliferation and the possibility of fibrosis. So very bad lesions that are inside these infiltrates. Okay, now if we turn to the immune response, in general terms, I may remind you that an immune response is composed of several branches that are, of course, very much associated in between them. The innate immune response, which comes first within a few hours, as we will see, followed, as you know very well, by the adaptive immune response that will come after 5-6 days with the antibody response and the T cell response. But we should not forget about the third component of immune response, which is much less well known, which is tissue damage control, that will, at the end of the infection, usually, hopefully, get to the resolution of inflammation and the reconstruction of destroyed tissues. So it comes with efferocytosis, so non-inflammatory phagocytosis of polymorphonuclear cells, for instance. The phenotype of macrophages as being anti-inflammatory with the production of related cytokines, and also the synthesis by the vessels and other cells of lipids that are very important, named the resolvins. So we should keep in mind that this part is also involved, being or not impaired in COVID-19, but this is very, very poorly known up to now. I will mostly discuss innate immunity and adaptive immunity and say almost nothing about this, but still remind, please keep in mind that this is also important. So let's consider an immune response to a respiratory virus, like for instance, an alpha coronavirus. What is occurring is that the virus will induce through the recognition of the pattern associated molecules by the receptors inside cells or at the surface of cells that are infected. This will induce within a few hours the production of type 1 interferon as well as type 3 at the level of epithelial cells, and some inflammation with the release of IL-1, IL-6, IL-18, with some cells dying. There are also danger signals released that are accompanying this first innate immune response. So this is followed, as you know very well, by the recruitment of the T and the B cells following activation of antigen-presenting cells. And after some days, sorry, this is in French here, jour, the days, these will fortunately lead to the clearance of the virus. And eventually, so this immune homeostasis step will get rid of inflammation and repair tissue. So that's the favorable scenario that occurs also with COVID, in the case of COVID-19, in most cases, but not in all. And this is what we are going to discuss. So this can be considered as being protective immunity, of course. So what is very important within innate immune responses are the interferon responses. So I remind you that upon binding of the virus to its receptor, its endocytosis, the nucleic acid, so the RNA from the virus, will be recognized by specific receptors like GRIG-I and MDA5 in the cytosol, the TLRs within endosomes, and this will lead through the signaling cascade to the induction of the type 1 and type 3 genes, and so their translation of the messenger RNA, secretion of proteins, and these proteins, the type 1 interference or type 3, will work either in trans, as shown here, or in cis on the very same cell. So by binding to its heterodimeric receptor, activation of kinases, JAK1 and TYK2, recruitment of transcription factors, and eventually this will lead to the transcription of potentially hundreds of important genes named interferon-stimulated genes, the product of which will fight against the viral infection. So there is a detection step, a transmission step, a response step, and an effector step. Okay, so this is a very complex system. We know that there are at least 20 different proteins of type 1 and type 3. We are not discussing here type 2, gamma interferon, which is actually very different in terms of function, as you know. So type 1 interferon have a heterodimeric interferon receptor 1-2 receptor, whereas type 3 binds to the interferon lambda R1 plus IL-10 R beta. The end products are more or less the same, and there are about 600 effectors, so interferon-stimulated genes that have been identified in the genome. So it's quite complex. And these ISGs, so the products of these ISGs, shown here by the red stars in the context of a given viral infection, they will act at all possible steps of the cycle of the virus entry, synthesis, and reproduction and release. So as you can see, I'm not going to discuss that in details, but you can find these red stars everywhere. So there are multiple ways by which these proteins can fight the viral infection, like the one caused by SARS-CoV-2. And on top of it, these type 1 interferons, they are very important mediators to trigger the adaptive immunity by increasing antigen presentation, for instance, by increasing the expression of HLA class 1 molecules at the surface of antigen-presenting cells, as shown here. They are also important to trigger B cell responses. So now let's go more specific to SARS-CoV-2. So on the left-hand side again, you have the scheme of the protective immunity when everything goes well. When things do not go well with SARS-CoV-2, it is as follows. It starts very likely, very important observation, related to different parameters. That is that there is an impaired type 1 interferon production, whereas the virus triggers a very potent and much higher production of pro-inflammatory cytokines as well as chemokines by the infected cells and related cells that are in the vicinity, like macrophages. So why is there a problem with interferon? First of all, because the virus itself is very good at inhibiting the production of interferon. This slide shows you the results of an in vitro experiment where epithelial cells have been infected either by SARS-CoV-2, in gray, or by the flu virus H1N1 in green. And then after a certain time, what is measured here is the production of the transcript for interferon beta 1, interferon alpha 1, interferon lambda 1, or three of these interferon signaling genes, stimulated genes, IFE2, DDX58, and MX1. And you can see in green that the flu virus is very good at inducing interferons and ISGs, although there are viruses that do even better. But in comparison to H1N1, you can see in gray that still SARS-CoV-2 induces some interferon and ISGs, but much less so than what does H1N1. And actually, it has been described that these beta coronaviruses, they do express a number of proteins that act at several levels, I will not detail them, that block or inhibit the production of interferon. So here within the cell are the names of proteins expressed by either the MERS virus or COV1, so the other two members of the beta coronavirus family that cause severe infections in humans. And here in this red square are the names of four proteins from SARS-CoV-2, NSP1, NSP3, ORF6, and the M protein that have been shown also to be able to inhibit the production of interferon, so to limit the interferon response. So there is an intrinsic capacity of the virus to limit the interferon response. And then it comes that patients with the severe forms of the disease, as shown in a study we have performed here in Paris, so those patients with the most critical, the one shown in red here, compared to the moderate, the mild, moderate, and severe cases, they do have limited response and production of type 1 interferon. This is the score of ISGs in controls. In patients with the mild form of the disease, there is some production of ISGs. In purple, these are the severe, so intermediate case, and in red, these are the patients in intensive care. You see that on average, this is low, although there is some heterogeneity, obviously. So there is an impaired response to type 1 interferon. This is measured in blood cells. Here is the detection of interferon. You see here again, it is, of course, increased in patients with the mild disease, but much less so in patients with the severe, the critical disease. So this is alpha interferon, and this is the global biological activity of plasma in terms of interferon. Nevertheless, this is a problem with the production of interferon, not with the response to interferon, because if one incubates ex vivo patient cells with interferon, one can get the induction of ISGs. It looks like maybe it is slightly diminished, but this is not significant comparing to mild, severe, and critical cases. So the conclusion here is that in severe, the most severe forms of COVID-19, the patients at risk to die, they have a low interferon response, and this is measured approximately 10 days, between 9 and 11 days after the initiation of clinical manifestations. And if one looks in a longitudinal way, one sees that it goes rather down. So it doesn't seem to be really a delay in response, but rather either an intrinsic inability or reduced ability to produce interference. This is an interferon alpha 2, but not just a delay in the response. And it could be that this quality of type 1 interferon is predictive of the outcome, because here is the, as a function of the ISG score, the ISG score of patients here, every single circle is a patient who did well, so they were stable, that improved, compared to those who worsened. Same here for the concentration of alpha-2 interferon in the plasma. Still, there is a lot of variability, which means that at the individual level, unfortunately, it is not possible to use these informations as a prognostic marker. But there is a tendency that low interferon response has a bad prognosis. So if I wish to summarize what about interferon and type 1 interferon and to some extent type 3 interferon in the context of severe COVID-19, we know that the virus itself is able to some extent to inhibit this production of type 1. Then we know that the comorbidities that are, or the age associated with severe disease, or being aged, diabetes, obesity, atherosclerotic disease, or being a man, they are all factors that are associated with a lower, not zero, of course, but a lower production of type 1 interferon compared to young adults, to women, and to people who do not have comorbidity. So these comorbidities, in part, may exert their bad prognosis by the fact that they're associated with reduced capacity to produce interferon. Then comes the genetics. I'm sure you're aware of the work of Jean-Laurent Casanova, as well as of a Dutch group, who have shown that approximately 3% of patients with severe COVID-19 have mutations. I will show the data in a second, impairing the interferon response. And of course, this further stresses the importance of type 1 interferon. And finally, there are patients, approximately 10%, who are developing autoantibodies to type 1. There is a question whether they are pre-existing or not. To my opinion, they are not. But of course, they may also contribute to the severity of the disease. So on this slide, marked by the red arrows, are the products or their genes that have been found to be mutated in some patients with severe COVID-19. And these are loss of function mutations in TLR7, TLR3, TBK1, IRF7, for instance, but also in a few occasions in the interferon receptors. You have the list of genes here. So obviously, to have an impaired type 1 interferon response is a strong predisposition factor to severe COVID-19. And recently, a group in San Francisco has shown that this paper is not yet published, but this is accessible, that they found that they detected antibodies in the serum, the R is missing here, in the serum of some patients with severe COVID-19, those who have interferon but no response to interferon. They showed that antibodies are depleting monocytes that are expressing these ISGs. In vitro, for instance, if you look at the induction of ISGs, like IFIT-M3, if you deplete these antibodies, then you restore, this is the orange and purple compared to the red situation of the severe patients. So you restore the production of ISGs. So it could be that there are, in some patients, antibodies that inhibit the interferon response. And this, they are depleting these antibodies, or this is associated with the depletion of the inflammatory monocytes, 14 plus CD14 plus CD16 plus. So an hypothesis that has been proposed is that at the time of viral infections, at the same time that there is an adaptive immune response that we'll discuss shortly, maybe by the brutal induction of ISGs, there is an induction of a kind of autoimmune response that may lead potentially to monocyte depletion, neutralization of interferon, and neutralization of cells that express ISGs, so further impairing the innate immune response in severe cases of COVID-19. Let's move now to discuss the adaptive immune response. Here you have a very simplified scheme indicating first in red the load of the virus in the upper respiratory tract. This is where it is most detected for the reasons I mentioned at the beginning of the talk. Then you have the lung viral load. So when everything goes well, it disappears after something like 1 week. And in green, you have the disease. The disease comes after 4 or 5 days following infection. And in blue and purple, you have the adaptive immune response, the T cell response that starts slightly before the B cell immune response. this is quite particular. So it starts around day 3, 4, 5, and it becomes full around day 10. So let's look to the B cell response first. So there are many, many papers describing the fact that most patients and all symptomatic patients do develop antibodies against the SARS-CoV-2, for instance, against the nucleoprotein, against the spike, and notably the receptor binding domain. This is shown here in two groups of patients compared to controls, IgGs, IgM against the nucleoproteins, IgG, IgM against the receptor binding domain of the spike protein. Not shown here is the fact that there is what has also been detected are IgA antibodies, which may be, of course, very important in these mucosae. Okay, very likely, very important for the control of the disease are the production of antibodies that can neutralize the virus, that is to impair or to block the capacity of the virus to enter into non-infected cells. These are titers of such neutralizing antibodies in different patients. They are mostly directed against the spike. Importantly, and maybe surprisingly, their titers are not correlated to the severity of the disease. Actually, what has been observed, maybe as a surprise, is that if you plot the antibody response here on the x-axis, IgG anti the spike, versus the severity of the disease or versus the age, you see a correlation. That is, the more severe is the disease, the more antibody there is, of course, with some variability, and the more aged is the patient, the more antibody it is. And this has been, these data are been extracted from a paper looking at these antibody levels at the time of resolution of clinical manifestation. So it looks like actually the more virus you have, the more antibodies you make. And so the antibodies are not a direct marker of protective immunity, although of course they may play a role. I'm not going to say that they are useless, but per se, they can't be a prognostic factor. What about B cell memory? Of course, this is extremely important in the perspective of vaccination. And the data that has recently shown are quite encouraging, because here are on the top left panel spike-specific memory B cells. Every single circle is a patient. So this is an analysis that goes up to almost 7 months, 7, 8 months post-infection. And you can see that one can detect in the blood such memory B cells, and it doesn't look like there is a decline. Same thing for nucleocapsid-specific memory B cells. And now if we turn to the follicular helper T cells that are, of course, critical for antibody responses, they are detectable. These are here the spike-specific activated follicular helper T cells in the blood. You can see that 6 months after infection, there are a little bit more as a mean that it is the case 1 to 2 months after infection. So this is encouraging for the stability of the antibody response following the infection. Nevertheless, there are variations as shown here in this study. Most of the people who have been infected have sustained detection of antibody at least for the first few months. These are not months 1 to 3. Here it goes up to 6 months. But there are some others here in black, so-called here in this paper, the decayer, where the antibody response looks to go down, at least the titer antibody, here the anti-receptor binding domain IgG goes down with time. And this comes with an hypothesis which I like very much. This is why I am showing the data to you. In this paper by Kaneko et al., published in Cell, they looked at the lymphoid organs from people who died, so of course the most severe cases, who died from COVID-19. And what they found is that in their lymphoid organs, they didn't find a terminal center. So the picture is as it is here. They are B cells. Actually, they are extrafollicular B cell differentiation and production, but no germinal centers. So this is a context which is associated with the production of antibody, but with a low rate of somatic mutations, so little variability, but still can be of relatively high affinity. They are not selected, so it's a context where autoantibodies may be produced, which may be important in the disease. Whereas in less severe cases or other instances of infections, other immunogens, the classical B cell response, of course, comes with follicles and germinal centers. selection of, as you know very well, of antibody with a high rate of somatic mutations, negative selection of auto-reactive B cells, so that there is no auto-antibody production. So maybe this situation may be associated with the production of auto-antibody, and this is just to show that indeed in the patients who are good sustainers in terms of the detection of antibody, their B cells, when analyzed for somatic mutations in the heavy chain or light chain of immunoglobulins, carry much more mutations as analyzed, especially during the first 2 months post-infection. So there is something here about an abnormal B cell response. Another aspect of the B cell response, which is depicted here with these yellow column, I will discuss other aspects of this slide later, is that within the group of asymptomatic individuals, those who are infected but do not develop the disease, and you know very well that this is frequent, those people, they make not so well antibodies against SARS-CoV-2. They have a low antibody production and can be transient, so they can lose their antibodies, which of course may have an importance in terms of risk of reinfection, although they may have T cell responses that might protect them. This is not fully clear up to now. So let's discuss now the T cell response to the virus. In the blood of individuals, of infected individuals, one can detect CD4 and CD8 T cells that are specific for peptides from the nucleoproteins, from the M protease, as well as from the spike receptor binding domain. Each column here accounts for a given patient. So of course, intensity is variable. Here, this is the measurement of interferon gamma production by CD4 T cells, but such a response can be detected. But there are interesting features of the T cell immunity that should be discussed. The first one, shown here by this red column, is the cross-reactivity of T cell responses with alpha coronaviruses. So in a fraction of individuals who have never been infected with SARS-CoV-2. Actually, in one given study here, this is 34%. In another, it's 50%. You can detect CD4 T cells, not CD8, but very few CD8, CD4 T cells that are reactive to SARS-CoV-2. And they are reactive to SARS-CoV-2, and it has been shown, because the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein in the C-terminal domain of the protein has quite a good analogy, a structural analogy, with the spike of alpha coronaviruses with which we are frequently infected. So the past infection with alpha coronaviruses may have led to this cross-reactivity and capacity to develop some, not a very strong, but some immune response to the COVID-19. And of course, the key question is whether these cells are protective. Nobody knows. Maybe they play a role in the fact that people, for instance, develop an asymptomatic infection. But this is just a guess. This has not been proven. So this was this. And now we have another aspect. This is the T cell response in severe cases that is not always normal. Unlike what I told you about the B cell response that always occur in severe cases and can be even more strong than in milder cases, this is not the case for the T cell response, and especially the CD8 T cell response. This is an example where the proportion of CD8 T cell responses specific for peptides of the different proteins of the virus has been studied by segregating patients with the mild infection in blue and those with the severe infection in purple. And you can see easily every single triangle or circle being a patient. You can see very easily that the frequency of CD8 T cell responding to spike, to the matrix nucleoprotein, to the off envelope is reduced. So the CD8 response are less intense in severe cases. Another aspect, of course, like I discussed for B cells, is the memory. So now there are a few papers that are starting to tell us about memory. So here is the specific CD8 T cells analyzed by binding to a vast range of peptides from the virus. You see that there is a decline. The half-life is approximately 3.5 months, both for CD8 and CD4, but still, in some cases at least, they are still memory T cells detectable up to 7-8 months post-infection, which is rather good news. Within the memory T cell pool, there is, as expected, a rise in central memory T cells at distance from the infection. So this is persistent, the memory T cell to the virus, but extremely heterogeneous among individuals, as you can see here. So maybe this may have an impact in terms of duration of protection. And we do not know today yet whether the presence of this memory T cell population correlates with protection. So let's turn now with the primary immunodeficiencies, a subject of common interest. There has been a study to which actually Lily Besrodnik participated to analyze COVID-19 cases among patients with these primary immunodeficiencies. As you know, there are more than 420 of these diseases. So data were collected mostly by Isabelle Mates in Belgium and Stu Tanguy in Australia with many of us, so including the colleagues from Argentina and other countries in Latin America, and data from 100 COVID-positive patients with a primary immunodeficiencies were analyzed. And if we consider adaptive immunity in terms of T-cell immunity, there is not really severe cases unless patients have comorbidities. And surprisingly enough, patients with agammaglobulinemia, some of them, 9 of them, have not developed a severe disease. There are a few additional ones where there is chronic disease or relapsing disease in the absence of antibody. But the only patients actually who did not well were those patients who had comorbidities. But of course, this is excluding the patients with interferon deficiency I discussed earlier, those ones are at high risk. But surprisingly enough, the risk of severe COVID-19 in the many classical forms of primary immunodeficiencies is not that high, unless there are comorbidities, of course. So which suggests redundancy of these immune responses, but of course not the fact that they are useless. So let me summarize what I have said up to now. I mentioned the fact that there is an impaired type 1 interferon production in severe cases of COVID-19. T and B cell responses, including neutralizing antibodies, are detected in most, if not all, of the cases. There is a possible pre-existence of a T cell memory in a fraction of naive people, likely as a consequence of cross-reactivity of SARS-CoV-2 with alpha coronaviruses with which these individuals had been infected in the past. And finally, there is an impaired CD8 T cell response in severe cases. But then we should discuss the other arm of the immune response in the context of COVID-19, which is the hyperinflammation that is characteristic of the bad severe cases, the life-threatening cases, sometimes named the cytokine storm or the hyperinflammation syndrome. So what has been observed by many people, many groups since the last spring, is that there is a high-level detection in both the plasma and the lungs of chemokines and pro-inflammatory cytokines, such as IL-6, TNF, but many others, in severe cases, those with these bad infiltrates and with these lesions. So for instance, in that study, by comparing the gene expression profile of macrophages from the lungs, so derived from bronchoalveolar lavage, comparing severe cases to mild cases. So you see here, for instance, these multiple dots account for genes that encode proteins that are chemokines. So there is a hyper expression of chemokines by inflammatory macrophages in severe cases compared to mild cases. In the plasma, the IL-6 is much higher in the critical cases, same with TNF-alpha and other cytokines and chemokines. So that the overview maybe as follows. So back to the very same scheme I proposed earlier. Now, in the bad SARS-CoV-2 case, there is, well, impaired interferon production, high level of cytokine and chemokine production, attraction of myeloid cells that further produce high amounts of the very same cytokines and chemokines, so that creating lesions. Also, they are impairing immune responses with lymphopenia, and through the production, among other factors, of tissue factor, may favor the occurrence of thrombosis of both arteries and venules. So these are several aspects of the bad cases, and we may call that, I think you would agree, pathological immunity. If I go into more details, this is a macrophage, this is a busy slide, I'm sorry, but the virus is here. The virus can directly trigger these inflammatory pathways, notably through NF-kappa-B, which is much induced, as we'll see in a second, and this will drive the production of these many cytokines and chemokines, as well as complement factors that play an important role. And the fact that the type 1 interferon response is delayed, of course, is favoring the replication of the virus and this vicious circle. So this is just to show you, this is in the blood, in leukocytes, both mono and polynuclear cells, that there is very much increased activation of the NF, pro-inflammatory NF-kappa-B pathway. A word about coagulation. This is representing a vessel with the endothelial cells, the monocytes, but and polyneutrophils here. So the endothelial cells themselves can be infected, as I told you, and this leads to the expression of activation markers of tissue factor that may induce coagulation. And in the same vein, monocytes themselves produce the tissue factor, express the tissue factor, will induce coagulation, and all of these factors may favor the occurrence of thrombosis. And on top of it, some patients have antibodies to the phospholipids that also favor thrombosis. So as a summary of this hyperinflammation, there is a role of the virus that directly itself induces through mostly the NF-kappa-B pathway the production of chemokines and cytokines as long as it is replicating. The atheromatous disease, but these cofactors of disease are associated, this is known for many years for some of them, with a pro-inflammatory status of monocytes. So monocytes are poised to be pro-inflammatory. So in the context of the viral infection, this is further increasing this cytokine production. There may be some genetic factors, but the most important one is probably here. So this is the so-called inflammaging, the fact that in aged people, monocytes, and to some extent neutrophils, but mostly monocytes, they produce a lot of inflammatory cytokines. They are poised to that. And this is also observed in patients with atherosclerosis, with obesity and diabetes. And this may further explain why patients with these comorbidities do develop more frequently severe COVID-19 infections. A word about genetics, which is intriguing. There are some data indicating that there are some variants in our genome that are favoring this hyperinflammation. Quite spectacular and recently published in Nature, there is a locus on chromosome 3, which is actually an haplotype derived from Neanderthal. So it comes from a mixing between Homo sapiens and Neanderthal. And this region of the chromosome 3 that is relatively frequent in Southern Asia, in Bangladesh, for instance, but also present a little bit in Europe, not that much in South America, not at all in Africa. But this haplotype corresponds to a region where there are genes encoding chemokine receptors. So it could be that these are gain of function for chemokine receptors, increasing the risk of inflammation. This is a risk factor, not very low, 1.6, but still this is significant. There are some genetic risk factors associated with complement, such as a diminished expression of CD55, which is a regulatory element of complement. There are some risk factors with signaling of TYK2, with coagulation factor. So there is a little bit of genetic susceptibility to hyperinflammation, even if this is not predominant. So if I try to put together everything I said, we can go to this model. So the virus itself, the comorbidities, sorry, here there is a mistake, and genetics a little bit favor impaired type 1 interferon production in bad cases. Of course, this is associated with increased viremia, and increased viremia favors, as I showed you, inflammation and thrombosis as well. The context is which type 1 interferon production is impaired, reduces the activity and the function of CD8 T cells as well as follicular helper T cells. So the defect in CD8 T cells, of course, further favors the viremia and the viral replication. And then the inflammation by through TNF and the reduction of follicular helper T cells leads to what I mentioned, which is probably occurring mostly in the very severe cases. This is an inability to form germinal centers to make antibodies and rather to have extra follicular B cell activation, which may lead to the production of autoantibodies. And interestingly enough, it has been shown in severe cases that more than 20% of patients have autophospholipid antibodies that may favor thrombosis. And then I mentioned the anti-interferon antibodies, the anti-ISGs presented at least 10% of severe cases that may favor and further reduce the production of type 1 interferon with a vicious circle. So all of these elements, one together, may contribute to the severity of the disease and perhaps also to the so-called long COVID syndrome where autoimmunity may play a role. Okay, I'm almost done. Just to mention in very simple terms that an effective immune response requires an appropriate production of type 1 interference during the innate immune response and obviously the development of an adaptive effective immune response. In the bad cases of COVID-19, for the reasons I just discussed, these may be impaired and leading to ineffective and deleterious immune responses. So these may be considered as far as we are looking at treatment with two possible strategies. The strategy is to reduce the viral load based on antiviral drugs. Unfortunately, up to now, we do not have any efficient antiviral drug, but it may come. The usage of neutralizing antibody derived from convalescent plasma or monoclonal antibodies may be of interest, at least in early phases of the disease. And perhaps, but this is still speculative, there are small few data, but not so many, early intervention with type 1 interferon may help, not late, because it is known that late intervention may be toxic. And of course, the second part is inflammation. So if it is possible at the same time to target inflammation and to reduce the deleterious response, this would be useful. As you know, up to now, only glucocorticoids have been shown to be efficient. This is only proven drug to reduce inflammation and death from this hyperinflammation. But many, many products are under considerations like antibodies neutralizing IL-6, TNF, other cytokines, anti-BTK, JAK inhibitors, anti-complement antibodies. Those, all of them are under evaluation. None of them have proven to be efficient yet. So my conclusion, sorry, here that was a mistake, but so the main conclusion is as follows. Severity of COVID-19 is associated with an inappropriate immune response that is secondary to viral factors, to host factors, both from genetic and above all acquired origin with the comorbidities. And altogether, this results in an ineffective and harmful immune response. What will be important for the future is to define reliable prognostic biomarkers at the individual level and not at the collective level, as I showed you, in order to define best what therapeutics to propose. So the therapeutics, they need to be validated along the both of the antiviral and anti-inflammatory strategies. And obviously the vaccine is a strong hope in this context where we have still little therapeutics. If you still have a few minutes, I don't know. I have a few slides about children. I don't know whether you want me to show them.
Yes, please.
Okay. So as you know, usually the course of COVID-19 in children is benign. And the question is why. So there are several possible explanations, and they are, of course, not exclusive one from the other. The first one is that in children, it is known that epithelial cells does express a lower level of ACE2, the receptor. So maybe the cells are less well infected. Second, by definition, children do not have comorbidities with exceptions. So and this may be a very important factor. Then comes the possibility of a trained immunity by recurrent infections. So we know all that small children have recurrent upper respiratory tract infections. This may train the immune system, the innate immune response, the production of type 1 interferon, so that it is very efficient to fight a new viral infection. And now, actually, there are a few data supporting this concept. Fourth, it goes a little bit together. Alpha coronaviral infections are frequent in children. So it could be that the cross-reactivity I discussed about T cells, but also about antibodies in this context, as I will show you, are protective of the children. And finally, children have T cell responses that are more robust. Sorry, there is a mistake here, but I will show that to you. So this is cross-reactive antibodies as a function of age. So children are there, and then are the adults. You can see that in adults, there are very, very few, on average, this is the gray line, very rarely antibodies that cross-react between alpha coronaviruses and SARS-CoV-2, whereas this is quite frequent in children. So these antibodies may be protective. And about the T-cell response, you can see as a function of age, here the production of IL-17A, the production of gamma interferon is higher, statistically higher in children compared to adults. So this more effective adaptive T-cell immune response may also protect the children. And my last word is to mention this syndrome, which is rare, the multisystemic inflammatory syndrome, the MISC-C, that is observed rarely, but still is observed in children, usually between the age of 5 and 15. Interestingly enough, not in all populations, mostly in non-Caucasian, non-Asian descent children. And this is a syndrome that occurs late after infection, on average, as you can see in that period of time, 5 weeks after infection. So it's a late consequence of infection. It is characterized by fever, gastrointestinal manifestations, rash, and I'm sorry here, there is an M that is missing, which is bad, and possible myocardic involvement, so heart disease, which makes the severity of this syndrome. There are multiple inflammatory markers. These children produce a lot of antibodies to the viruses, but also autoantibodies against endothelium, against the gastrointestinal tract, against the immune cells themselves. It is not known whether these autoantibodies are pathogenic, but it looks to be quite a hallmark of this condition. And these patients have very severe mucosal inflammation, production of chemokines attracting myeloid cells, production of cytokines such as IL-6, IL-17A. But overall, the pathophysiology of this condition is still poorly known. Again, it's a rare syndrome, but of course, it's life-threatening. Also, usage of high dose of immunoglobulins plus corticosteroids can control this bizarre syndrome. And with that, I will stop here. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. We open the question, please. Eli Chisse.
Thank you, Dr. Fischer. I'd like to congratulate you for this wonderful talk. And I'd like to begin with my own personal question. Based on our current knowledge about the immune response against SARS-CoV-2, what can we expect from the current vaccine under development?
There is a great hope since, as you know, at least the new kinds of vaccines based on RNA, messenger RNA, developed by the Pfizer company as well as the Moderna company, have shown efficacy, at least short-term efficacy in phase 3 studies. So now these vaccines are being evaluated by regulatory agencies in America, in Europe, and other places. So hopefully they will be used soon, next year, but soon, to prevent the disease. Of course, they are still unknowns. The data are based on short-term evaluation, not more than 2 to 3 months, but this is better than nothing, with a very high level of protection. And we do not know about the duration of the protection. And the other key question is whether the vaccine will protect against transmission of the virus, something or only will protect the individuals who have been vaccinated. We'll know in the future. But the hope is really strong today to get something good for protection. And then, of course, there are other generation of vaccines, the one based on adenoviral vectors, the one based on the recombinant protein plus adjuvants, the one based on modified replicating viruses. So there are several strategies that with vaccine that will come along the year, the next year, that may also provide more ways of preventing the disease.
Well, a lot of people saying thank you very much, Professor Fischer, for this excellent talk, me too. One of the questions is, why in the same family that all live together, not all of them got the disease? What do you think about
Very good question. I would love to know the answer. I do not have the answer, I'm sorry. This is clear that not everybody gets the infection in a given family. So of course there could be genetic factors, but that's too easy to say that, especially within a family. It could be that the quantity of viruses that are infecting is variable, so that some people can go through without an infection. I really do not know. The proper answer is today is this is something that is quite mysterious. But this is not specific to COVID-19. I mean, this is something that has been observed with other viruses.
Another question, if how much people, health people that took a positive antibodies after the infection, and how much people who got the disease of COVID that got
secondary disease. So the frequency at which people can have the infection twice, that's the question.
Yes,
the frequency. As far as I understand now, there are a few hundred cases reported, which is still very low given the number of infected people in the world. So we do not know the exact frequency. My guess is that it will not be very frequent. It does exist, but it's probably not very frequent.
And someone tell that in Cuba, they are using intravenous interferon for all the people who got the disease. What do you think about this this strategy?
Well, I would not recommend intravenous. I would recommend intramuscular or by nebulization. But as I said, this is maybe interesting at early steps of the disease, so to induce, to have a much better interferon response. There are some evidences in experimental models that late administration of interferon may be harmful. So one should be cautious not to treat patients with an advanced disease. But early, it might be interesting, but this has not been strictly proven yet. There are a few clinical trials that are suggesting of efficacy, but this is not fully proven at this stage.
Another question, why CD4 decrease during the infections?
Well, not only CD4, there is a global lymphopenia. All T cells are down, the B cells are down, except for the plasma cells that are increased. This is probably also secondary to the hyperinflammation and maybe induction of cell death, or plus or minus disturbed cell circulation. But there are markers of cell death, so of apoptosis in lymphocytes in severe cases. But there is a recovery then in patients.
And Mr. Benjamin is asking your opinion about the role of interleukin 17 and 23 cytokines in the pathology of severe COVID and the presence of Th17 cells in the autopsy of the first deceased patient from SARS-CoV-2?
From what I understand, it doesn't seem that Th17 cells play a major role, neither in protection nor in immunopathology. Maybe this is the case in the MISC, where there is this high production of L17A, but this is not so the case. Of course, there is some Th17 responses, but it doesn't seem to be predominant.
Another question, as you mentioned during your talk about cross-reactivity with alpha coronavirus, do you think that is a good option for vaccination with alpha coronavirus?
Well, first, there are no vaccine against alpha coronaviruses. So better to have a vaccine directly directed against the SARS-CoV-2. rather than an indirect protection through another virus against which we do not have a vaccine.
Another question is about molnupiravir, the treatment to inhibit the replication of SARS-CoV-2. What do you think about this?
Well, from what I know, up to now, there are no drugs, not a single one, including hydroxychloroquine, that was very popular in France sometimes, that are unfortunately effective. Remdesivir also is not very effective, and I don't think anyone so far has demonstrated that there is an antiviral drug. But I know that there is very active research in this field, and perhaps, I hope, we'll see later next year, for instance, the emergence of new drugs, this time no repurposed drugs, as it was the case so far, but new drugs that may block the virus cycle and that may be useful. But two considerations: probably to be efficient, they will have to be given early in the course of the disease. And second, there should be more than one, because if there is only one, there will be rapid induction of resistance. So we will probably need to combine, as it is for HIV, for instance, where you treat patients with three drugs. Maybe something like that should be used if there are such available antiviral drugs.
Another question is to study the immunity response. Do you suggest it's better to study antibodies to nuclear protein or antibodies to S protein?
It depends what you want to do. It's just for diagnosis. Yes. I mean, to detect the anti-spike protein is enough. I mean, this is only for research purpose that there is an interest to go into details.
Perfect. And Professor Fischer, Ekaterini from Brazil is asking your opinion about the possible benign effect of BCG induced trained immunity.
Yeah, I am aware of some papers and studies that may suggest that there is an effect of BCG, typically as a way to induce trained immunity. I think this needs to be confirmed, but this is an interesting possibility, not yet, to my opinion, fully demonstrated.
Another question. In this patient with autoantibody to interferon type 1, do you recommend a SARS-CoV-2 vaccination?
Well, for those patients with primary diseases where there is anti-type 1 interferon, like APCED, air deficiency, I think it would be good to vaccinate these people because they are able to make antibodies to develop T-cell responses, and they are at high risk of severe disease. I'm aware of two patients in France who died, children, who died from COVID because of this air deficiency with the presence of anti-interferon antibodies. So yes, I think those patients, as well as those who have an interferon deficiency, well, like a mutation in TLR3, for instance, those should get the vaccine as soon as possible.
We have an interesting question from Dr. Condino from Brazil, asking your opinion of what to expect from vaccine responses in patients with antibody defects, T-cell defects, or combined defects. Should we consider using anti-SARS-CoV-2 medication containing specific antibodies or monoclonal or polyclonal?
But I think clearly in patients who are gamma globulinemic or have poor antibody production, have a recurrent or chronic disease, convalescent plasma or antibodies are useful. This has been shown, this is published. And then in terms of vaccination, we do not know today because we do not know how important is the B-cell response, the T-cell response for protection. Perhaps the T-cell response is also important. So perhaps it will be good, not yet, but in the future to vaccinate patients with a B-cell immunodeficiency, at least to provide them with T-cell immunity to the SARS-CoV-2. We'll see. This is a bit too early to draw final conclusions and make recommendations.
Another question from Dr. Jutun. Have you seen severe combined COVID-19 in patients presenting autoinflammatory diseases and interferonopathies?
Yes, this is a very good question. I have no direct experience, and I know patients with such diseases who have made mild or had asymptomatic COVID. I will not draw too many conclusions at this stage because the numbers are small, and I haven't seen any paper relating more cases. So this is something to be looked at. I have no definitive data and conclusion about these cases.
I have the question in the YouTube. Mauricio Flores Morales. In several post-COVID patients, we saw secondary immunodeficiencies and immune dysregulation. There are study or intervention promoting immune recovery?
Well, I think we do not know enough about this so-called late COVID syndrome. There is the suspicion, as I said, that there is maybe autoimmune, but we lack data yet before making recommendations. Well, at least personally, I am unable to make recommendations. Those cases should be studied in detail, especially to look for autoimmune markers. But it's too early, at least for me, to draw any conclusion.
And Gabby Dominguez, is the severity of the disease related with antibody production, detection, or duration of immunities against coronavirus?
No, the antibody production is good in all cases, apart of patients with primary immunodeficiency. With the exception of asymptomatic cases. So the problem is not with the antibody production. Well, in terms of quantity, I mentioned that in the severe cases, it could be that the antibody production is only extra follicular. So this might have an impact in the quality of antibodies as well as in the production of antibodies against autoantigens. But I don't think primarily that the problem with the B cells. I think it's the combination of defective innate immunity, as I discussed, with impaired T cell response, as well as the induction by the virus of the inflammation that causes overall the severity of the disease.
Another question, if there is a lot of autoantibodies in these cases, could rituximab could be an option for the treatment?
So, rituximab?
Yes.
With caution. I don't know, perhaps, but I don't know yet. I mean, I have no personal experience, one, and second, we have to be cautious not to... To deplete the an immune response that may be useful. So I'm not saying this is not a potential indication, especially perhaps in patients with autoantibodies against interferon, or antibodies against phospholipids, but I will be cautious before using them.
Another question about cross-reactivity with other vaccination, like BCG, mumps, do you know if are cross reactivity to SARS-CoV-2?
Not that I know.
Do you suggest to vaccinate the people who had suffered the infection? Do you suggest to vaccination these people?
The only thing what is known today is that part of the people who were involved in the, I think, the Baxter phase 3 study had antibodies prior to immunization, and this did not create any side or adverse events, and that they might have, but this has to be looked at, an increased antibody response. So maybe it's not worth excluding them from vaccination, although the indication, of course, is not as stringent as for naive people, but perhaps there is no need to do an antibody test before vaccination.
Okay. In critical case, a patient with pneumonia that we can't measure IL-6, but other lab are increased. Which treatment do you suggest that if we can't use?
In all critical cases, glucocorticosteroids, that's for sure, and anticoagulants, and oxygen, of course. Then there are clinical trials testing different strategies of anti-inflammatory strategies, but none of them so far has proven to be efficient. So what is absolutely accepted and now is the standard of care is the usage of glucocorticosteroids plus anticoagulants. And I'm sorry, I will have to leave in 1 or 2 minutes because I have an appointment, just to let you know.
Okay, last question. In CVID patients, do you recommend an extra treatment with gamma globulin at the moment of the diagnosis of COVID infection?
No, I think you should do the immunoglobulin replacement as it is scheduled. I don't see any need to do more, not to do less, just to continue the normal treatment.
Okay.
Well, for the time of our professor, thank you very much. You are very generous with us, and we like. I'm sorry, because.
No, it's okay. Go ahead.
We like to participate in vivo. The next
time, I hope. Next time.
Yes, next time in our meeting in Chile, please,
South America.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great honor.
Goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Goodbye. And gracias a todos por estar. Gracias por estar con nosotros. La verdad que fue super. Fue sumamente generoso el doctor Fischer. Sabíamos que tenía otra reunión, por lo cual decidimos dejarlo libre. Y a ustedes, los que están en Argentina, que puedan disfrutar el fin de semana largo y en el resto que disfruten el próximo feriado. Y antes de fin de año haremos toda la comisión directiva un encuentro para despedirnos y esperar que el 2021 nos encuentre juntos a COVID, con muchos proyectos. Y gracias a Eli Mansur y a Gisela Seminario por acompañarme en este momento, y como todas las semanas y los días, que el trabajo es sumamente duro. Muchísimas gracias a todos y nos vemos prontito. Gracias. Hasta luego.
Gracias.